exact day and hour? No one knows that, not even heaven's angels, not even the Son, only the Father. So keep a sharp lookout, for you don't know the timetable. It's like a man who takes a trip, leaving home and putting his servants in charge, each assigned a task and commanding the gatekeeper to stand watch. So stay at your post, watching. You have no idea when the homeowner is returning, whether evening, midnight, cockcrow or morning. You don't want him showing up unannounced, with you asleep on the job. I say it to you, and I'm saying it to all, stay at your post. Keep watch. Today is our Sunday school prize giving. It's a family service. And so today's word is designed for that. I wondered, what is it that turns this, a pumpkin seed, into this? What are the things, what's required for that to happen? I suppose you could say, of course, there needs to be soil, water, and sun are essential, the care of a farmer. But there's one other key ingredient that we mustn't forget. The way that a seed turns into a pumpkin is really through waiting. Through waiting. And so Jesus, in this wonderful little parable, says that life is like a man who goes away, perhaps on holiday, and leaves a group of people who look after his house and property, maybe a gardener, housekeeper, domestic worker, and of course there was that gatekeeper to keep watch. And then Jesus says that those servants, those who are left behind to look after the house, they have to stay awake. They might have had to work out shifts or things, but they had to be on guard. They had to be ready for when the homeowner returns, because it was the day before cell phones and there was no warning to say the master is on his way back. They can't just sit around aimlessly. They must be prepared. They have to be ready. They can't be lazy in their waiting. They can't just lie around on the couch watching TV. They have to keep watch. It's all about being ready. Apparently, I don't know how they work all this stuff out, but apparently if you live to be 70 years old, you will have spent 3 years of your life just sitting around waiting in the queues of the shops or at the petrol station, waiting at the doctor's office, waiting for lunch to be ready. If you're at school, you'll spend a good part of your life at school, waiting for school to start and other things to happen. And Dr. Zeus has this fun little poem where he says, waiting for a train to go or a bus to come or a plane to go or the mail to come or the rain to go or the phone to ring or the snow to snow or waiting around for a yes or no or waiting for their hair to grow. Everyone is just waiting. But the good news is there are two kinds of waiting. Not all waiting needs to be bad. There's one, which is like the one we've described, where you sit around getting bored and doing nothing. I remember as a child, I hated waiting. I hated waiting for a lift. I hated waiting, having to sit in the car. I hated when my parents went to visit people and we had to just sit around waiting for the visit to be over. As a child, I hated it. As an adult, I still hate it. When on some Saturday morning, Sharon and I are about to leave the house, I say, "You ready to go?" She says, "Ready to go." And I get in the car and I reverse up the driveway and then she's not there. And sometimes I sit in the driveway waiting for 5 minutes. I said to her, "Where have you been?" She said, "No, the dogs need fresh water," or she decided to change her outfit, or she decided she needed to tweak her makeup or something. It's just waiting. But there's this other kind of waiting, which is very good. In fact, it's exciting. You can come up with this, I'm sure, but it's about, for example, waiting for a birthday can be very exciting, or waiting for Christmas, or waiting for a present, or waiting for a special holiday. It's all the planning, it's the anticipation, it's the imagining, it's the looking forward. Waiting can be a wonderful thing. Our grandson loves waiting for ice cream after lunch. If we promise him ice cream after lunch, then lunch gets transformed. And this pumpkin that I've shown you today, let me lift it up again for you. This pumpkin, maybe I'm mad, but I find it amazing. I find it incredible that you can just put a little seed like this into the ground. And that after, of course, with the care of a farmer, with the wonders of sun and soil and water, but then just with the patience of waiting, a little seed like this gets turned into a pumpkin. Our pumpkin, by the way, weighs 7.7 kilograms. That something so little can become so big through the gift of waiting. And there's so many good examples of good waiting. Maybe you can think of a few. Waiting for a baby to be born is one of life's great joys. A long marriage is really an expression of waiting. It's hanging in there with each other. Going to school or university, from when you're just little to when you graduate, it's a form of waiting. In fact, If you think about it, the very, very best things in life, on the whole, almost without exception, the very best things are the product of waiting. And so for centuries now, the church has set aside the month before Christmas to get ready for the birth of Jesus, for us to re-wait, if you like, to wait again for the birth of Jesus. And we call that month Advent, which really just means Jesus is coming. Yay! And it's a wonderful discipline of the church. Because there are lots of people, and it's not just people outside of the church, in the church too, there are lots of people who actually don't care about Christmas. Certainly not the heart of Christmas. Of course, most of us care about the things that usually happen at Christmas time. Most of us love the idea of presents, and we love the food and the gathering and the holidays that many of us take time off then. But I think you'll find the number of people who really care about the heart of Jesus, the heart of Christmas, is not huge. Don't get me wrong. All those other things, the food and the family and the presents and the holidays, all wonderful and good things. But Christmas, if we want to talk about Christmas, we want to talk about what it is we're waiting for. That stuff, it's really all about Jesus. Sounds like a cliche, but it really is. It's all about Jesus. Above everything else we do, it's about Jesus, about his heart, about his values, about his life, about his promises, about his hope. It's all about Jesus. And long ago, the church realized, even in a world unlike ours, the church realized how easy it is for us to get caught up with all these other things that happen at Christmas time, to get caught up with life in the course of a year and forget about the story of what happens at Christmas time, to forget about Jesus. So it's excellent that we put aside this time where we can wait for Jesus again, where the goodness of waiting can be ours. Not waiting in a boring way, not like me waiting up the driveway for Sharon to eventually come out of the back door, but to wait for him like a farmer waits for a pumpkin, or a mother waits for a baby, or a little boy waits for his ice cream after lunch with joy, with anticipation, with hope, and with goodness. So I just want to leave you with three quick things, if I can, that I think can help us in our waiting. Can I say, think of Jesus every day, perhaps especially for this season, but think of Jesus every day. If you're a little person, if you're a young person, ask someone to say a prayer with you each day, and to read a Bible story to you or with you each day. Up until Christmas, keep that going, just every day. For adults, there's some wonderful devotional books that can walk you through Lent. But stay with Jesus, be with him every day. And by the way, just quickly, because it's school holidays doesn't mean it's time to stop worshipping. It's interesting to watch churches often empty out over Christmas time. Don't. Stay with Jesus every day. The second thing I want to suggest to you is going, when we want to stay with Jesus, one of the best ways we stay with Jesus is to care about the people Jesus cared about. Now, of course, Jesus loved everyone, but we know that he cared especially about poor people because he recognized that most people looked down on or ignored the poor. So again, if you're a young person, ask mom or dad to help you do something for someone who needs help. And if you don't need a mom or dad to help you do it, then you do something for someone who needs help. Perhaps resolve to do one good thing for someone who needs help each week up until Christmas time. Maybe you just want to do one, but commit yourself to doing one good thing for someone who needs help. Because when we do something for someone who's in need, we actually open ourselves to God in a way which is literally like nothing else. And I really mean that. I mean, it's nothing like prayer, it's nothing like reading the Bible, it's nothing like going to church, it's nothing like fellowship. It's quite unique when we offer ourselves to someone with a kind heart. It's a transforming thing. I'm hesitant about telling stories like this, but I wonder if I could quickly say, a couple of months ago, I was in the queue at Checkers just buying a handful of things. So I was in the quick queue. And there was a young man in front of me, and I hadn't paid particular attention to him, but then he left the queue, and he came back with one more item. And that drew my attention to him, and I noticed that he was someone who looked like he was probably working on maybe a building site or something like that. and he had come to Checkers to buy some simple things for lunch for the day, or maybe even breakfast. And then I felt like, I mean, really, like as clear as a bell, this thought, if you like, it wasn't an audible voice, but it could have been just this thought, buy his lunch for him. So I turned to him and I said, sir, would you allow me to buy your lunch for you today? And he wasn't sure what it was exactly I was offering. So the lady at the till said to him in isiXhosa, explained to him what I wanted to do. And he was so grateful. He smiled with just such humble gratitude. And I sent him on his way and blessed him. And then the lady at the till, who now seemed to have some tears in her eyes, just said to me, God bless you, sir. And I just want to be absolutely clear here that the young man might have been blessed with a free meal, a simple free meal. The lady at the till might have been moved by a moment of kindness. But I want to tell you, beyond a shadow of a doubt, the true blessing, the one who was most deeply gifted, is the one who listens to the prompting of the Father. And so to do that, stay connected to Jesus. And do that by loving the people that Jesus loved. The last thing I want to say is our passage today ends with the word, stay at your post. The instruction is, if you are left to look after the house, stay at your post. And we won't go into all the details of what Jesus was meaning in that sense directly. But it is a direction for all of us when it comes to following Jesus to stay at our post. In other words, let's not only be excited about Jesus at Christmas time. Stay with him all the way through the year. Organize your life so that every day becomes a way of waiting for Jesus, of getting ready for Jesus, of staying at your post for Jesus. I must confess again, I've said it to you before and I'll say it again, that I've been both surprised and maybe even the word is saddened at the way COVID has affected the church across the world. I think most of us have felt some kind of knock. And I don't want to stand in judgment on this, but I do want to say I can't believe how many people seem to have just given up. I know in the tumult, people might have changed churches and done other things, but it feels to me like some people have left their post, that they've stopped waiting, that the tumult of COVID changed things for them. And I wonder if this Advent and Christmas can't be for people an opportunity to renew their commitment to Jesus, to be called back to their post, to wake up from their bored waiting and again feel the excitement and the joy and the anticipation of waiting for Jesus in our lives. And so maybe one of the things you can do in this Advent season is just to give yourself to thinking, in 2023, how can I be a more faithful follower of Jesus, one who waits for Jesus in a more devoted kind of way. So these three things: think of Jesus every day, care for the people Jesus cared for, and stay at your post. Thanks for being here. God bless you.